Welcome to Comedians Versus the News. I'm Eman El-Husseini.
And I'm Jess Salomon.
Hey, I see you're drinking from your favorite mug.
Yep, it says Bay. Best and ever.
Greatest job in the world.
It's like being a grandparent, but young.
Like being an uncle people trust.
Right. We zoomed in to my five-year-old nephew Benji's class to talk to them about comedy this week, which was so much fun. Eman, tell everybody one of your jokes.
All right. Where do cows go for entertainment?
Where?
To the movies.
All the kids guessed. It was so embarrassing. And where do adults with good taste go for a funny global take on this week's headlines?
That's a tough one.
Eman, they come here.
Right. From the BBC World Service, this is the show that breaks down the news with the help of superstar international comedians.
Because laughing is your whole body smiling.
Oh my God, our audience is not five.
It still applies, all right? And with us today are two incredible guests who I'm sure will agree with me from the United States. She's one of my favorite comedians. She's also an actor. It's Aparna Nancherla.
Hi.
Hello.
Thank you. Yes. Thanks for having me.
And from South Africa, we are joined by award-winning comedian and actor Schalk Bezuidenhout.
Yay!
Well,
you said that you are sure I will agree with you. I do agree with the award-winning comedian part.
Right.
And Schalk. I don't agree with the whatever the last thing was, but thank you. I'm flattered, and that is what I love about my surname. It's exotic, it's pronounced different everywhere in the world.
I get that too with my last name, El-Husseini.
Me too.
El-Husseini.
And then Charla as well. I get bad spellings of Solomon. Sometimes that people spell it solo man. Like it's a one-man show. I don't know. I might just have a one-man show one day of just all the different spellings. Solo man.
I feel like you try to join the conversation, Jay, saying mine's also as bad as people just butchering your surname. But yeah, I feel like A changing to an O is not so bad.
I've been introduced the oppression. I'm sorry.
In front of big crowds as something that I didn't even walk on stage. I didn't even know the guy was calling me on.
Aparna, do you agree that laughter is your body smiling, or is that something that's just too optimistic for these times?
I mean, I agree. You know, when I'm not doing well on stage, I do like to say that people are just smiling loudly. So I do think laughter and smiling, they're really sisters.
They are.
Sister forms.
I think that's the only part of the body that laughs are the shoulders, right?
Yeah, that's true.
The shoulders.
Yeah.
That's a laughing.
I always like it when people are like full body laughers, like when they're like falling out of their chair. That really makes you feel good as a comedian. You're like, I made them spasm.
So let's get into the stories of the week that have grabbed our guests' attention. Schalk, the British monarchy has obviously been dominating the news and Netflix.
Yes.
Why do you think so many people are consumed by the royal family?
I do know why in Britain, because they're the royal family. But what I don't understand is how it Well, I do understand and I don't. Like, because it also dominates South Africa's headlines.
Oh.
Yesterday I went on the news and that's all I saw. You know, and there's so much happening in South Africa right now besides for COVID. Like, half of our politicians are in court, always in court, never in jail. You know, it's like,
And then I
was seeing like Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. But, you know, with Afrikaans people, we love the royals. I don't know why. Maybe we developed Stockholm syndrome while we were being colonized. I don't really know who's who in the royal family. I know Queen Elizabeth. And I know Prince Harry's, I know Meghan. The rest, like, I'm unsure. I know the names, but I don't really know who's going to get the throne when the Queen passes away. I'm not so clued up. But, like, your older generation Afrikaans people, they know exactly who's who, who's going to get the thing if that person doesn't want the thing anymore. And, yeah, they know how many diamonds are in the crown, mostly because it was stolen from South Africa. So it's kind of just like, we're keeping an eye on those diamonds. We know how many there were when they left.
They didn't take diamonds from Canada, but you know, what are they called? The beefeater, the soldiers that have the big fur black hats.
All those beavers.
Oh, that protect the palace?
Yeah, the palace guards, that fur, that comes from Canada, from I want to say black bears. You know what? I should double check that, but
please.
The black bear community are going to be up in arms.
They're going to be so mad.
I get into it, and part of it for me is that my grandmother, for some reason, was like just a total Anglophile, obsessed. If a product had the royal symbol on it, the jam or the pear's hair shampoo. I mean, she bought all that stuff. So I associate it with her.
I mean, I'm the same age as Prince William, so I do remember when I was a teenager, everyone had a crush on Prince William because he was like the same age as us, and we were all like, maybe one of us could marry him one day, and little did we know we didn't even have a chance.
I know. My grandmother, I think, was holding out hope that one of us, my sister, I would marry Prince William too.
That was the only way she was going to okay you not marrying a Jewish guy. If it's Prince William.
Oh, yeah. In that case, forget it. She'd be like, don't even tell them you're Jewish.
Right.
You know what that means?
It's time for a game segment. Winner takes nothing.
Well, nothing but the fulfillment of a job well done, because we don't have real prizes.
Unless someone wants to sponsor this segment. We need a home gym.
Yeah, things are opening up. Spring's here and we are not ready.
Hold on. I'm hearing from our producers. Yep, still not allowed to solicit sponsors.
Well, then thank you once again to the only sponsors we need, supporters of British Public Broadcasting.
Aparna, Schalk, are you game?
I'm game.
So game number one is complete the headline.
In this game, you have to guess the missing word in a recent headline covered up by our puppy Esther Honey's bark.
Okay, first headline. Malala partners with to produce dramas, comedies, documentaries. Malala partners with to produce dramas, comedies, documentaries.
Donald Trump.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Likely partnership.
Oh, mm-hmm. Wow.
He needs a job.
I was going to go with the more conventional, less funny option, Netflix.
Mm. Ooh, okay.
But I still think I'm wrong.
Who is Malala?
One of Donald Trump's ex-wives.
Really? Are you serious?
Malala Trump. I don't know if you've heard of her.
No. Mm-hmm. No. No. I'm not very clued up on American politics. How's Joe Biden doing,
You're so
by the way?
Lucky.
How's he doing? Is he doing well? Is everyone proud of him? Are you
Nobody
guys...
knows. There's no headlines breaking on the weekend.
Oh, yeah. It felt like all the journalists went on vacation as soon as Donald Trump left.
Oh, my word. I just Googled who Malala is. Okay. Wow.
What did you
did
find?
Did you really not know who she was?
No, I now, you know, because I actually only called her by her surname, Yousafzai. You know, I like surnames. I like learning how to pronounce them and stuff like that.
Right,
so
right.
That's an attack on me. I get it. The answer is Apple. Malala partners with Apple.
Aparna was close.
Right, Aparna was close. So the documentaries make sense, but I'm curious what comedies Malala is thinking of producing. Get ready for Emily in Islamabad. Malala and Apple, Obama and Netflix. You really do need a Nobel Peace Prize to break into the entertainment industry these days.
And I'm very excited also for Greta Thunberg's Amazon Prime comedy special. Going to start activism. I just need to find something to active.
I'm sure there are a lot of people in entertainment who just think activism is another way of saying exercise.
Right.
I mean, I've been very activism all my life.
I've been on my Peloton this morning, hashtag activism.
Next, complete the headline. First dogs leave White House over incident. First dogs leave White House over incident.
I think the first dogs left the White House from the first peeing incident.
Okay.
Aparna, what do you think?
I was going to go with the other option, pooping incident.
Okay. Keeping it potty.
I think Biden made them leave because he was like, I'm the only one that pees myself in this house.
That's my lane.
Yeah. Marking his territory. That makes sense. But the answer is, you guys, first dogs leave White House over biting.
What?
President Biden's dogs, Major and Champ, were sent to Delaware after several instances of aggressive behavior.
Several! So how many Secret Service agents had to go, hey, Mr. President, it wasn't that sore, it's fine. And he's like, are you sure? Yeah, it wasn't hard at all. Until eventually it's like, guys, we need to speak to the president. This is really getting out of hand. That last one drew blood.
Okay, here we have a next headline. Unilever drops the word from beauty products. Unilever drops the word from beauty products.
I'm going to say they dropped the word whale from beauty products.
There is a lot of petroleum jelly Unilever.
It was time.
It was time to let it go.
That answer is coming from
you can see where the upset would have been if it was still in the beauty products.
I think fair, because that implies skin tone. I feel like there's a lot of products that have fair in them.
Yeah.
That implies white. Mm-hmm. It's a polite way of saying white.
The answer is normal. Dove's owner said the editing ban would apply to body shape. The editing ban would apply to body shape, size, proportion, and skin color, and normal would be removed from 200 products. So shampoo for normal to dry hair will soon be called shampoo for dry and damaged hair. I can't think of anything more empowering than being called damaged instead of normal. We did it, ladies.
I mean, that's my shampoo brand, Dry and Damaged.
Okay, that's guys. My therapy brand.
Dry and Damaged?
Yeah.
My is actually the opposite of dry and damaged, and it's wet and healthy. That's also my therapy brand, wet and healthy.
Have you got a joke to share, a hilarious story, something unique to your part of the world? We want to hear it. We're recording a special program next week, and you can join us.
Get in touch on social media using the hashtag ComediansVSTheNews or email us at ComediansVSTheNews@bbc.co.uk. We'd love to hear about the funniest stories where you are.
So it's been a year since the pandemic started, an anniversary no one is celebrating, and the latest side effects are making us, oh man, Aparna, I had a question for you and it completely flipped my mind.
Yes.
Can you tell us what this story is that you brought and who am I? I don't remember.
Yes, so we are in a late stage pandemic world and one of the side effects is memory loss, and some of this is just from long-term stress and being bored. Apparently, if humans are bored for long periods of time, it is not good for you. Hmm. What makes our brains more resilient is being exposed to novelty and stimulation, and it turns out that sitting in your apartment refreshing your browser does not count.
So is the memory loss like a self-defense mechanism because we're going through a traumatic period of time?
Yes.
Or are we like erasing all memories of joy and are just going to be left with the memory of this pandemic?
Well, some scientists think it's a short-term thing. It's kind of like we are creatures of habit. So now that all of our habits are wearing masks and social distancing, that's at the front of our brain. And all the habits like going out to dinner with a bunch of people have gone into deep storage. But they think it will come back when we get back into regular life again, but they don't know what the longer term effects of this prolonged stress will be.
Have you felt this effect yourself personally? Have you noticed your memory lapsing?
I already feel like my memory was going a little bit. So now I can blame it on something, which is nice.
That is good. And what about the idea of getting back out there and the stuff that's in the deep storage drive. I'm a little bit nervous.
Like, I don't even, if someone asked me to hold their baby, I think I will say I can't.
You've forgotten how?
I've forgotten how.
So before the pandemic, you were holding a lot of people's babies.
A lot of babies, yeah. Constantly.
What about you, Schalk? Are you...
I never get asked to hold people's babies. I'm the one who asks, can I hold your baby? And they say no, because you look like a scary clown, because you've got big curly hair and a mustache. I don't believe the story. I think the scientists are wrong, because boredom does not lead to memory loss, because I have a great memory and I grew up as an only child. And that is the most boring childhood you can ever ask for. An only child, you don't have brothers and sisters to entertain you. You were saying we need stimulation. No, we don't. I spent so many Decembers, summers in South Africa just sitting in the house because we couldn't afford to go on holiday. Mm-hmm. So I've done probably 18 hard lockdowns in my life.
Okay, and you started young, so your brain's been preparing. You've been training for this your whole life.
The lockdown was honestly just felt like a December holiday in the Bezuidenhout household.
I grew up with a younger sister and a younger brother, but I always wanted to be an only child. And I have a great memory. So I back up your theory.
Yeah, so...
Only children or wanna be only children have great memories.
Aparna, what do the scientists say about that theory? Is there any data?
There was a weird paragraph at the end that said, and if you're an only child, just don't even start with us.
It's just because you could entertain yourself. I could see that. Right.
Yeah. They're like, you're too far gone, and this applies to normal people, not dry and damaged people.
From New York City, this is the podcast that takes the headlines to a laundromat, because who has room for a washer-dryer? I'm Jess Salomon.
And I'm Eman El-Husseini, and you're listening to Comedians Versus the News on the BBC World Service.
Eman, have you heard about deepfakes?
You mean when a woman's in bed with a man and pretends?
No, I'm talking about hyper-realistic videos of people where they say or do something they never did.
Can I get one of you saying, Eman, you were right. COVID is a real thing.
I was the one who first took it seriously. I was washing the groceries.
Deepfake ya.
Wow, okay. I really got mad there for a second. Anyway, the most I can do technologically is put a photo of myself through a balding app to see what I'd look like with a shaved head.
You'd think you have a pretty enough face to pull that off, but no.
Last week, 3 Tom Cruise deepfakes went viral on TikTok. And if not for the user handle @DeepTomCruise, I know, it wouldn't be obvious they were fake.
What did fake Tom Cruise say? I'm 5'10 and I'm not a Scientologist?
No, the videos are him doing magic, playing golf, and sharing an anecdote about Gorbachev.
I'm going to show you some magic. It's the real thing. I mean, it's all the real thing.
Maybe I've lost my ability to distinguish between fact and fiction.
Yeah, that's the point.
But I believe Tom Cruise is behind this.
Is Tom Cruise to blame for deepfake technology? Is he behind this? And if you were to make a deepfake, what would it look like?
Well, I'm just glad I have something to blame my nudes on. depends which one they use, which one leaks onto the internet.
It could be a positive deepfake. Yeah, that it does look like The Rock's body, but it's actually mine with my head on it. Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, filters on Instagram are already deepfakes.
They're already fakes, yeah.
Right? We're already in a deepfake world.
I went on a date with a girl, and I was very surprised when I got there that she didn't have cat ears. And I was like, that's not cool. I thought I was coming on a date with someone with cat ears. That's
where catfished comes from.
Yeah.
Like,
I was like, that's
unique. I said I would only see a therapist with cat ears.
Right. You got to lay your boundaries down, right? That's part of it. Aparna, what if you were to make a deep fake, if there was a deep fake of you, what would you like to fake?
I think I'd fake, I know this probably doesn't work anymore, but I think I would fake showing up to social events that I didn't want to go to that prove I was there.
Ooh. Like, oh, good one.
Destination weddings. Even though now I'm sure everyone's like, I would love to go to a destination wedding. I think in the future it would be helpful to not have to go to everything again.
That's a billion-dollar idea. Somebody, that's a deep fake technology niche that I think people would subscribe to for sure.
Yeah.
And now to add some much-needed gravitas to this week's headlines is a man so British he's never once seen the sun.
Hello, this is Nigel Winterbottom enjoying a very British plate of chicken tikka masala, something we invented. Here are this week's headlines.
Thank you, Nigel. I'm not sure India would agree, but you say it with such authority, we have to believe you. BuzzFeed announced a series of widespread layoffs at the Huffington Post weeks after it acquired the company. Employees found out they were fired after they were sent a listicle titled 47 Signs You No Longer Have a Job, while the CEO of your company is worth $200 million.
Capitalism. Woo!
Piers Morgan is leaving the TV show Good Morning Britain, which means Britain will finally have a good morning.
This week, China's top lawmaking body unveiled plans to ensure only patriots can govern Hong Kong. No offense to China, but weaponizing patriotism to promote a nationalist agenda is kind of America's thing.
China says they're at least 30 years away from becoming a manufacturing great power, to which the entire world replied in unison, but everything we own is already made in China.
Where do I get that kind of motivation, Iman?
I'm going to go ahead and say China.
Scientists have discovered sea slugs that can chop off their heads and grow new bodies. That is so sad. Imagine you finally reached your fitness goal of having no physical body, and then it just grows back.
Last week, during a historic visit to northern Iraq, Pope Francis celebrated Mass at a stadium in Erbil, attended by thousands despite COVID-19 concerns. Upon his departure, the Pope said Iraq will remain in his heart. A friendly reminder to the Pope, tightness in the chest is not Iraq. It's a COVID symptom.
Stay safe, Pope.
Billionaire Mackenzie Scott, ex-wife of Jeff Bezos, married a science teacher at her children's school. Nothing says taking revenge on Jeff Bezos like a union with a guy in a union. Bruno Mars wrote an open letter on Twitter begging the Grammys to let him perform this coming Sunday, March 14th. Did his letter include his lyrics about being too hot, hot damn, called the police, and a fireman, too hot, made a dragon want to retire, man?
Man.
Whoa.
Aparna, give us the details. Did the Grammys, you know, read this letter and were like, you know, police, firemen, this is getting too expensive, COVID, too risky. What's happening there?
Yeah, so he has a new album coming out. He's collaborating with another musician, Anderson .Paak, and they have a new group called Silk Sonic. He tweeted at the Grammys, they said, we just released a song and could really use the promotion right now. We're just two out-of-work singers, and we just want to sing, and we'll take the COVID test. We'll send in an audition tape. And then, twist, the Grammys tweeted back and said, you can perform at the Grammys.
What?
Yeah.
I did not. They were always going to perform, guys.
That's what I think too. I think the whole thing is a publicity stunt.
But I'd like to believe that it's not. All of us know that no matter what level you are as a comedian, you still always ask for 5 minutes somewhere.
Have either of you guys ever taken a big step to tweet at someone or message someone and put yourself out there?
Well, I mean,
to do a gig?
Yeah, I did a lot. Like when I started,
I'm not shocked. I'm actually not shocked, but I just...
When I started comedy, I was like, wanted to open for like big names, and you would be surprised at how many famous comedians in South Africa I've opened for just because I sent them a message, and I ended up opening for Trevor Noah for a month in a 2,000-seater theater just because we did a comedy festival together, and he was early on the lineup, he'd broken his foot, and he was on crutches. So he performed at the beginning of the show because it was painful for him to stay on crutches for that long. And one night backstage, I just said, "Trevor, please, can you stay one night and just watch my set? I really want you to watch my set." And then he was just like, "Okay, cool." And then I opened.
So cool.
And then I opened for him. And then I opened for him again and again and again and again. But if I never just like literally asked, because I was like, what's the worst that can happen? He'll just say, no, sorry, my foot hurts. And then he'll leave. So I'm a firm believer in like, you don't ask, you don't get.
Aparna, have you ever taken a big risk? Or like, I know you book shows, you play big theaters and stuff.
I was thinking about it the opposite way on Twitter. I always find it disturbing when brands tweet at me. Like sometimes I'll tweet something about like pizza or something, and then a pizza brand will respond in a jokey way. And it kind of creeps me out because I'm like, I know you're not a talking pizza. You're just some underpaid social media intern.
But what are they offering you?
Glad you enjoyed me. That's weird.
Are they offering you free pizzas? What are they?
They're just trying to get in on the joke. They're not even giving me anything.
Oh, that's not right.
Yeah. Maybe if they were like, and you get a free pizza, then I'd be like, yes, haha, very funny.
From New York City, we are the podcast that take the headlines to our local coffee shop to order from their side window because it's cool and COVID safe. I'm Iman El-Husseini.
And I'm Jess Salomon, and you're listening to Comedians Versus the News from the BBC World Service.
The AstraZeneca vaccine was rolled out and rolled right back in South Africa. It's been reported that the jabs don't seem to knock out the stronger strain of COVID-19. Schalk. Is the variant a formidable, unbeatable heavyweight champion? What is happening?
Yeah, well, firstly, you know, I think South Africans, we were pretty offended that Britain just immediately tried to pin the new variant on us. They all started calling it the South African variant instead of the new variant. And we were like, whoa, where did that come from? We went there and you came here. It could have been from anyone, okay? It's like after an orgy trying to blame the STD on someone. It's like, look, it could be from anyone right now. I didn't plan on saying that. That was just something that came into
patient zero in the orgy.
Yeah, that just popped into my head. That's what it's like, though. Everyone's mixing. Everyone is very excited in South Africa. Like, yeah, we got a vaccine. And, you know, you have to always remember we're a third world country. So if we get a vaccine at relatively the same time, you know, like movies, we always get late. You know, we know all the movies, what's going to happen because of spoilers on Facebook before we see it. So when we got the vaccine relatively at the same time that first world countries were getting it, we were very excited. And they did some tests and it was like 22% effective. And, you know, people were freaking out. Oh my word, it's only 22% effective. But I think, you know, that's just basic maths, you know, because I kept telling people, I posted it on Instagram and everything. I said, just take 5. It's that easy. Then 22% times 5 vaccines, that's 110%. Yes. Then you fully immune. Plus you've got 10% because, I mean, winter is on its way in South Africa. Extra 10% for the weight that you pick up in winter always. And I think that's just basic maths.
I think a medical school should give you an honorary degree.
Yeah, I really don't know how the world's top scientists and doctors, I mean, that's a huge oversight. What are we paying taxes for?
Absolutely.
If a comedian is solving this vaccine,
problem. Duh, guys, come on.
Hello.
Keep up.
Hello.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe it's because I was an only child, so I had a lot of time to really train my brain.
Yeah, Aparna, have you been vaccinated?
I have not. I think that's probably what people who aren't vaccinated will do now for entertainment. They'll just look online for appointments, or maybe there'll be a whole video industry of just people are vaccinating, going out and living their lives, and the rest of us will just watch them at home and be like, wow. Could be me one day.
I finished all of Netflix. Let me watch these vaccinated people out in the world, see what
just
that's
doing
like.
Just doing very basic things like shaking hands and hugging.
I don't know how it is, all over the world, but I feel like everyone is making a vaccine these days, because this was like one company. When the vaccine started, we all knew like, oh, okay, this company is making a vaccine. And then suddenly there's like, oh, and these other 10 companies are now also making a really good vaccine. I feel like if you have got the money and the resources, you can make a vaccine. I think McDonald's is going to bring out a vaccine soon. If you just upgrade your meal with $2, I don't know if that's a lot of money, but then you can get a vaccine at the drive-thru. And a guy dressed as Ronald McDonald does it. He injects you.
I mean, I feel like they use clowns a lot in hospitals with kids to convince them to take shots,
to not
you know.
Be scared.
Yeah.
It's weird to use a clown to tell people not to be scared.
It scares adults. But not
or
kids,
maybe they're so scared of the clown they don't realize they're getting shot.
Right.
Exactly. There's a giant needle going in their arm, but they're like, ah! Is there a company that you would like to see get into the vaccine game?
I think I want to support more small businesses. I want a small batch vaccines, artisanal, customized. Oh, yeah. I want a hipster vaccine.
So now it's time for Ask CVTN, a safe space for world leaders seeking confidential, no-nonsense advice.
We're gay, but we give it to them straight.
All right, we've got a good letter here. Okay, here we go. Dear CVTN, I am not a world leader, but I am many people's queen. Not a Her Royal Highness, more like a yes, queen. I'm writing to you from Santa Barbara, California, where I've been enjoying a semi-retirement after a career as a talk show host and interviewer. So good, I charitably stepped away to give others a chance. Unfortunately, no one is good. Last weekend, I decided to interview, let's call them Larry and Tegan. It was a flawless primetime blockbuster, and predictably, the calls for me to return to TV have been resounding. I'm known for sharing my lists of my favorite things, but I guess you could say I am many people's favorite thing. CVTN, do I have a responsibility to return to TV because there is no one good? Do you know who expressed concern over Archie's skin color? It's killing me. I couldn't get that answer. Signed, you get a car, and you get a car.
Oprah Winfrey!
Eman! It's what? Anonymous. This is anonymous.
Oh, right, right, right. Of course, of course. Dear, you get a car, and you get a car. And I never got a car, but I love you.
What's your advice?
Okay. Look under your seat. The answer awaits.
Okay, mysterious. So my advice is don't come back to TV because we all want you to. Listen to what your heart and Gail's heart tells you to do. Aparna, Schalk, do you have any advice for you get a car and you get a car?
Well, she already started her own network. I mean, I'm assuming she's anonymous, but
she
seems like she already started her own network. So I feel
maybe more behind the scenes.
But people want to see her on air, so I don't know, something, what hasn't she done? Gone to space? Maybe she goes to space.
I think, yeah, that's a good advice to consider space as a new frontier.
Televise it.
Yeah, televised.
Like the moon landing.
Televised space content.
I can't really tell how big or small this person's career was. I'm assuming it was pretty small by the sounds of it. I would suggest really look at exploring other options, maybe starting a YouTube channel. That's how a lot of people, you know, get famous, like Justin Bieber.
We want to hear from you, our listeners, our fans, and especially Oprah. Do you think we should take comedians versus the news to television? We're ready.
Nothing is more dynamic on television than watching two people podcast. We also love compliments, especially mine, who's, you guessed it, a Leo.
Sleepy Tank Girl wrote, after inundating myself with serious news and self-improvement podcasts all week, this is like a fizzy, cool, and super delicious lemonade on a hot day. Yum.
That review was yum.
You're yum.
A big thank you to both of our guests for being here. Schalk, Aparna, where can people find you?
People can find me on Facebook, Schalk Bezuidenhout, and Instagram at Schalky Bez.
Skulky Bays. All right. And Aparna?
Yeah, you can find me on Twitter or Instagram at Aparnapt. weekend.
Well, thank you guys so much for being here. You've been so fantastic.
You're so great.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Comedians versus the News. Presented by me, Jess Salomon.
And me, Eman El-Husseini. The producers are Mugabe Turia and Olivia Skinner.
AKA Moogs and Ollie. Rate, review, subscribe.
Tell your friends.
Tell the world. Until next week.
As Tom Cruise says in Mission Impossible,
hasta lasagna. Don't get any on ya.